Good morning, and welcome to worship this morning. I trust the mic is on, and you can hear me. That's good. It's exciting this morning. Drove out to 24 to get on 24, and the sun was shining so brightly I could hardly even see the cars coming from one direction. It was a little dangerous, but it was beautiful to see the sun. So I would welcome you all this morning and ask you to rise and welcome each other. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome again. Okay, our opening hymn this morning is In Thee Is Gladness. We make our beginnings in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you for this mercy, and for the sake of your holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death, of our beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, our confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of Christ, announce the grace of God unto you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I am excited to be able to share with you and assure you of the forgiveness of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We come into God's presence with the words of Isaiah 61:10. Let us share them together. I will sing praises to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exalt in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself, like a priest, with a beautiful headdress, and a bride adorns herself with jewels. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, now, and will be forever. Amen. Glory be to God on high. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you invite us to trust in you for our salvation. Deal with us, not in the severity of your judgment, but by the greatness of your mercy, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated as we prepare for our Old Testament reading. Kathy's going to share that with us.
The Old Testament reading for today comes from Isaiah chapter 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle comes from Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have received your concern. We have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. If any in every circumstance I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. This is the word of the Lord.
Please rise.
The Holy Gospel according to Saint Matthew, the 22nd chapter. Parable of the wedding feast. And again Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son, and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fattened calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry and sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall is filled with the guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Let us share together the word, our words of faith from the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the sermon hymn, "A Multitude Comes from the East and the West." Well, we look at our worship folder this morning, and we see a man climbing a cliff. And we see the words that Paul wrote in verse 13, I can do all things, through him who strengthens me. And I think the question, I got to thinking about who we are as human beings and how we deal with doing all things. And can we really do all things? We seem to want to, we frequently try to, but can we really? And how do Paul's words in today's text deal with that? I happen to have a couple of great-grandchildren and another one on the way almost momentarily. So we'll see how that goes. But little ones, when they reach a point of walking and talking, what is the first thing that they, besides no, the other thing that they say is, I can do it myself. And do it theirs, and they will try anything to do it by themselves. Of course they can't. And so mom and dad and grandma and grandpa help them, and we pick up heavy things and they hold on to them so they can carry them, and we do all of that, and it's great fun. But they can't do it by themselves. And of course, a lot of times we can't do things ourselves. But we get to a place that we understand the things that we can't do. And sometimes we get real honest about that. And we say, well, I really can't do that. And sometimes we get kind of stubborn about that. I might be guilty of that. We should be asking help to do something, but we take the approach that I can do it myself. It's kind of a guy thing, and I'm probably among those who would have to say guilty as charged on that one. And so I get stubborn, and I do some dumb things. Over the past 30 years, my son-in-law and I have done a lot of things together. We've rebuilt a couple of houses, we've put on decks, we've built garages, and for much of the 30 years, I was able to say with him, I could do anything that he could do. He's a pretty good sized guy and he's pretty strong, but I could stay with him. I can do it, was kind of my motto. Then just a few years ago, we were going to build a deck on the back of a house that they had in Eureka at that time, and we needed some equipment. I happened to have a pretty good size, what they call a power miter slide saw, and I lived in Rockford, so I loaded that saw in the back of my car and drove to Eureka, backed in the driveway. And I walked down around the back and got my son-in-law, and we looked at the project and looked at what we were going to do. And we walked back up to the car. I intended to pick that thing up out of the back of the car and take it down to the work job site. I opened the back of the car, and my son-in-law walked over, and he picked it up, and he headed down to the site with it. As I stood there watching him carry that saw, a lot of different things went through my mind. You know, why would he do that when I was going to do it? But the reality is, I was relieved. Probably for the first time in my life, I was totally at ease and at comfort with him doing this when I fully intended to. And the thought, just because you maybe can do it, doesn't mean you should do it, ran through my mind. How does this fit Paul's writing today? In Paul's letter, verse 13, we read, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The truth is, Philippians 4:13 does not promise you that you can do all things I know that a lot of us have used this verse as we tried to do things when we were facing something difficult. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, right? Well, that's not really clearly the total meaning here. I've heard preachers use this and say, tell me how God can do all things and he will help me do all of those things. Well, that sounds interesting. And I am sure, I know without question, there are things that God has wanted me to do, that he has called me to do, that I have not done. And I know for a fact that if I had answered that call, he would have helped me. He would have been there to do that for me. But to think that he will bail me out on any of the crazy ideas that I come up with is a little bit foolish. And it's simply not the case. We can all come up with a list of things that we can't do. For example, there is no way that I could run a marathon. If somebody says to me, we're going 26 miles, I'm getting in the car. we're not doing this on foot. God can do all things. There is no question of that. And if there was some really incredible or unbelievable task that God needed for you or I to do to the glory of his kingdom, he would give us abilities beyond our imagination. That's true. But the reality is, with a lot of the stuff that we come up with, that's not going to happen. It is said that this verse is one of the most misinterpreted verses in the Bible. The text can be seen printed on sports apparel and frequently quoted by athletes. I can do all things. Motivational speakers will frequently use this verse to bring across a message of inspiration. You can do all things. As Christians, we sometimes use this verse as we believe that anything can be accomplished and done through God. Verse 13 seems to say that. And so we're quoting that. But we have to be careful, because when we take verse 13 out of context, we miss the point. And missing the point can be deceiving, misleading, and sometimes downright dangerous. As a matter of fact, that verse actually doesn't really talk about the ability or being positive or faith. This promise, I can do all things, was part of a larger section and a larger issue. And only if you keep it in the context of what Paul was teaching will you understand what Paul was saying, what God was promising. So I'm going to read a few verses before that to put this back in context. Go back to verse 10. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you were renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I'm in need, he said, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, he said, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or living in want. And then we hear the words, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When Paul wrote this letter to the Philippian church, he was in prison. His predominant purpose for writing this church was to thank and encourage them. The Philippians knew full well that Roman imprisonment was tough. It was not easy. And so Paul, realizing the concerns that his people had for him, assured them that he was in good spirits. He was telling them that suffering comes, but as Christians, as believers, we can endure and we still can be joyful. When Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," his message was that of learning to be content in all circumstances, to be joyful when it seems strange to do that. The strength from Christ is not something that will change or contradict Paul's current situation. The strength that he was talking about will not bring him out of prison. For Paul, as we see the context, we hear Paul saying, "I can handle this. I can do this. I can handle all things." And that did not mean doing something extremely difficult or accomplishing some monumental task. It meant staying true to Christ. All things referred to any and every situation of verse 12. Doesn't make any difference what the situation is. Doesn't make any difference what he was going through. He could handle that because Christ was with him. So what Paul was saying in verse 16 was the same thing that he had been saying in verse 10, 11, and 12. I can handle or do any situation. He said, basically was saying, I can do hungry, I can handle being hungry, and I can do being full. And then he would say, I prefer being full, but I can deal with being hungry. He said, I can do being free. I can handle freedom. And I can also handle being a prisoner. I can do that as well. Oh, I prefer to be free, but I can deal with this being a prisoner. He said, I can do lonely. It's okay. He said, I can do that. I can handle being alone, and I can handle having friends around me, having fellowship with others. He said, I prefer having friends around me, but I can deal with the other, with Christ. He said, I can do having nothing, being naked, or I can do being well clothed. He said, I much prefer being well clothed, but I can handle the other. It's okay. Through Christ, by his strength and with his help, I can do whatever circumstances I find myself in. We can have exactly the same contentment that Paul had to any and every circumstance. We live in a crazy world. Circumstances are getting goofier by the day. But we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That is a great promise. And the secret of that promise takes us back to Philippians chapter 1, verses 21 through 26. Listen to these words. Paul writes, "For to me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. If I'm going to go living in the body, this will be fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that my being with you again, your boasting in Christ will abound on account of me. Was Paul talking about being victorious over prison, over the government, over loneliness, over fear? Paul didn't know that he would be victorious. Paul was in prison. He might die, but he was content, whatever way it went. Can we say that? Would we be content in prison or lonely or without anything or hungry? Could we do that? How could we be so content in any circumstance? The same way Paul could. His mindset, his focus, his desire was Christ. To be obedient to Christ, to honor Christ, and to serve Christ. Paul could say, if I live or die, it is Christ. If I am loved or hated, it is Christ. If I am rich or poor, makes no difference, it is Christ. Paul was so content either way, to the point that he didn't even know which one he preferred. That's pretty incredible. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it's more necessary that I remain to be with you. Here, then, is the promise. When we get so focused on loving, serving, obeying, proclaiming, and pleasing Christ, until we don't know which circumstance we would choose, we will have contentment. And we will be able to do or handle or to be content in any and all circumstances. We will be able to do all circumstances. Then we will understand truly the truth and the power of Paul's statement when he said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen. Gracious Lord, Father, we bring these gifts. Father, we pray that you would use these gifts to show the world, Father, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We can survive all circumstances. We can handle anything, Father, that the world comes. Lord, we pray that you'd use these gifts to portray the truth to a hurting world. Amen. As we begin our time of prayer this morning, I received several prayer requests this week. Jim Doherty called to let the church know that Diane was back in the hospital. That was on Friday. She is at OSF, and so we pray for Diane today. Another one, Liz Reed stopped in. She had a heart murmur and is going for an echocardiogram on Monday and is worried about that. And she would like some prayers as well. I understand Sally Thomas had a stroke on Thursday and is in intensive care at the hospital in Peoria. And so we pray for Sally. And then there's some excitement this morning. Tim Matern, Weiss's oldest son, Ryan Alley, and Allie Widmer are having a baby girl by C-section on Monday. And Grandma also shared with me that her birthday is on Tuesday. So Grandma is more than just a little bit excited as we pray for this brand new baby. And I also need to add to that, my oldest granddaughter is also expecting. The due date was to be on November the 7th, but the ultrasound, they said the other day, there is no way you are going to make it till November the 7th. And as it turns out, my daughter and her husband are out of town this weekend. So guess who's on call? I'm holding my breath and praying as we complete the church service that I don't get that phone call. But anyway, it's just exciting. The little ones in our lives just, they bring tears to our eyes, don't they? So let us pray. And as we conclude the prayer, I will ask you to rise for the Lord's Prayer. Oh, gracious, loving Father, Lord, we just thank you, Father, that we could be here today, that we live in a place where we can come and we can rejoice and we can worship you and we can share our difficulties and we can share our joys and we can rejoice in the fact that we find joy in your presence no matter the circumstance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We glorify you, God, that you have given such authority to men to forgive sins in the name of Jesus Christ, whose blood made atonement for the sins of our world. Focus every word and deed of your ministers in this church toward this office, that the gospel may predominate our worship and life together. And Lord, I had conversations this week with someone who really needs to understand forgiveness. I pray for him. Lord, in your mercy, hear me. Heavenly Father, you call your children to put off the old man of sin daily and live together in the forgiveness of Christ. Fill our homes with your Holy Spirit. Leave no place for the devil, but work your righteousness and holiness among us. Lord, in your mercy. Father, today as we pray, we think of the leaders, certainly in our country, the leaders in the world. Father, we think of the nation of Israel, of those that were killed, the children that were lost and killed, those that were captured and held hostage. Father, we just pray that We pray that you give the leaders of, again, this country and the world understanding and knowledge and reason to come to conclusion of this and put a stop to these kinds of acts of terrorism in our world. Lord, in your mercy. Father, you bestow healing on our bodies, above all to show your power and to forgive sins. Lord, we've talked about Diane and Sally, and there are others, Father, that I expect we are not even aware of. But you know the needs, Father, of our church, of our congregation, of our friends. And so we pray for healing. We pray for your healing touch, your healing hand on those who are hurting. And Father, we also at the same time come to you with joy as we celebrate new life, new birth. You know, we think of the baby to be taken by C-section on Sunday, and we think of my granddaughter's baby also to could be born at almost any minute. And we pray for healthy little ones, we pray for joyous little ones, and we ask you to put a smile on our face and a tear in our eye as we see these beautiful little ones in our life. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, your healing and forgiveness are united in the ministry of your Son, Jesus Christ. Make us whole through the reception of his grace, and spread it abroad for the comfort of those broken by this world. Father, we come to you, and we thank you, Father, for your Son. And we conclude these prayers, Father, as we rise now and share the words that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Bless we are the Lord. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Now you may be seated for the closing hymn, Savior, Again Thy Dear Name We Rise. Have a great week. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thank you so much. It just made my day to see you come in.